Hello, in this episode, we're going to take a deep look at VoxEdit's modeler mode. If you're not familiar with VoxEdit, I suggest watching the previous video for a brief orientation. There will be many changes to VoxEdit as it moves from alpha to beta and version 1.0, so be sure to check for an update video in the description if you are in a version newer than alpha 3.15. This video is sponsored by the Sandbox's Creator Fund. Visit fund.sandbox.game to learn more about this program. From VoxEdit's welcome screen, we're going to click the modeler button, which will open a window to name the new file and pick a save location. Like I said in my last video, I like working from a Dropbox folder so my files are automatically backed up with version history if I ever need to recover a lost or corrupted file. If you plan on making a rigged model with multiple objects, it's helpful to create a dedicated folder because each object and the rig will be separate files. Taking a look around the screen, we can see a menu bar along the top, a toolbar on the left, our work area in the center, material picker and palette on the right, and tooltips along the bottom. Let's start by adding some voxels to our work area. Make sure you have Create Mode and the Pen tool selected. I know it looks like a pencil, but if you hover over it, the tooltip calls it a pen. If we left-click on the bottom or sides of the cube grid in the work area, voxels are placed on the square we clicked. If you left-click and hold, you can see a preview block, showing the exact placement of the new block when you release. Voxels cannot be placed in the air, but if we want floating voxels, we can build up to the position we want, click Erase Mode, and delete the supporting cubes. Just like the Create Mode, voxels are only changed when left-click is released, with a red highlight showing which voxel will be removed. For faster building, the right mouse button is always an eraser, so you can leave your tool in Create Mode, add voxels by left-clicking, and erase them by right-clicking. This is true for all the other tools. Right-clicking always removes voxels. The third mode is Paint, which will change voxels to whatever color is selected in the palette. Try clicking another color swatch and painting a few voxels. The click and release work similarly, but you can see in Create Mode, the preview voxel is small, and in Paint Mode, the whole voxel is highlighted. The other three tools besides the pen are Box, Face, and Flood. The Box tool creates a rectangular prism stretched diagonally from where you click to where you release. Just like with the pen, you cannot place floating voxels, so you need to plan where you want your box to be. Sometimes it's easier to start with a large volume and carve the shape you want out of it. But if you need to add voxels stretching out into an empty space, you can build out gradually to the corner and then stretch the box from there. The Face tool controls all voxels of the same color, sharing an edge on the same plane. This means voxels just touching at the corner aren't affected, and neither are voxels using a different palette swatch. Finally, the Flood tool controls entire volumes of voxels. This is also only for voxels of the same color, and they have to touch face to face, not on the edges or corners. The last button on the toolbar is the pivot control. This lets you define where the object will rotate if it's added to a rig. We'll go over this more in another video. Looking at the work area, we can see a voxel counter and frames per second in the upper left corner. The camera button in the lower left corner captures a transparent PNG image of the work area and saves it to the VoxEdit folder located in your user account folder. The bottom right corner enables or disables the axis display. Different 3D programs define the axes different ways. For VoxEdit, red is X, left and right, blue is Z, depth front to back, and green is Y, height top to bottom. In the top right corner, you can shift all voxels in any of the six directions. The colors of the arrows match the corresponding axes. The cube icon lets you turn off the wall grid or all grids, which also disables the ability to place voxels on the work volume edge. If you are not hovering the mouse over a button, the tooltip describes the camera controls. Alt left click lets you rotate around the center of your work volume, unless the mouse is over an object, in which case the camera rotates around the nearest voxel. Alt right click lets you pan the view left, right, and up down. The mouse wheel controls zooming. You can always click the reset camera button at the far right of the menu bar to move the camera to its original position. At the far left of the menu bar is the home button, which will prompt for a save and bring us back to the welcome screen. Then you have a save button, and the mode indicator reminding us we're in model mode. If we were editing a model that was part of a rig, the home button would be hidden, and there would be a rig button next to the model button, allowing us to return to the rigging mode. The set of three arrows allows us to rotate the entire object. Pressing each will rotate the object in 90-degree increments around the axis selected. The next buttons increase and decrease the model resolution. This can be helpful for quickly blocking out a rough shape, then increasing the resolution and carving out more details. If your object is more detailed than you need it to be, you can shrink the resolution. Be careful though, once you lower the resolution, those details are gone and can only be brought back with an undo. Speaking of undo, there isn't a button on the screen for it, but hidden away in the edit menu, you can undo or redo 10 times, or use the shortcuts shown. Select all and deselect all are not implemented yet, but hint at selection, transformation, and copy-paste functions in an upcoming version. Back to the menu bar, there is a button to turn on mirroring for each axis. This lets you build symmetrical models quickly, with gray planes to show the center of reflection. The next three boxes are for typing in the size of the work volume. These can each range in size from 1 to 256 voxels. But be careful when working with large volumes. A full-size volume is over 16 million voxels. I tried using flood fill and the program took almost 10 minutes to completely fill, and then ran at 2 frames per second until it crashed a few minutes later. Even with an empty max volume, I still only get 14 frames per second, and it takes a few seconds to place individual voxels. My suggestion is to wait on building your epic city in a single object until the program is more stable. The last function button is Trim Volume, which will automatically shrink your work volume to fit the voxels inside. This is helpful when creating rigs later, so the bounding box doesn't get confusing. The next four buttons are the different display settings. Voxel edges display every edge like a grid. Quad edges show how the program will convert the voxels into a mesh. Nice edges only appear on 90 degree angles, showing the edges of each face. Finally, hide edges does just that, hide the edges. Moving over to the material picker and palette, we can see that these panels are special. By clicking on the right corner, we can pop the picker out to see more of the palette at once, or pop both out to maximize our work area. You can even resize the palette to show all your colors. This is extra helpful if you have multiple screens so you can make the most of your space. In the material picker, there is a large color preview, a saturation and brightness grid, and a hue spectrum to select colors. You also have the ability to manually type in values for red, green, blue, hue, saturation, brightness, or hexadecimal codes. The magic wand button will set a material to glow, indicated by the star on the preview. Pressing the save button will apply your changes to the selected palette swatch and update any voxels using that swatch with the new color. VoxEdit can have up to 256 colors per object file. It can also save and load palettes in the same PNG format used by Magicka Voxel from the menu on the right corner. The new palette button will remove all unused swatches and leave only ones currently being used by voxels in the model. New swatches can be added by clicking the plus symbol. Right-clicking on a swatch gives a menu for replacing or deleting voxels. The replace button does not seem to work at this time, but I think in a later version it will let you convert voxels from one swatch to another. The delete button not only removes the swatch, but all voxels using it. This is a way you can quickly remove voxels used to place floating objects. Finally, let's take a look at the file menu up top. Besides the new open and save functions, which are pretty straightforward, there is an export menu with several options. OBJ, DAE, and GLTF are all common mesh formats supported by a wide variety of 3D programs. I was able to import all three into Blender, though GLTF required an additional plugin. VXT, or Voxel Tile Map, allows an export, but this feature is not documented yet, and I'm not sure how it works. There are plans for a tile mapping tool to create your own worlds in the game, so I'm sure how this export function works will be revealed later. VXR Skeleton, Block, and Marketplace exports are not working at this time. Check the link in the description to learn more about the upcoming Marketplace and how artists will be able to publish their creations. Thank you for watching, and I hope this video gave you all the information you need to start building your own models. In the next video, I'll be going over how to create a small character and break it up into separate objects for rigging. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and click the notification bell, and leave your questions in the comments for help.